It is autumn in the Canadian province of Manitoba. Here, far from towns and cities, is a region that has scarcely been changed by man. This is the northern limit of trees, the borderland of the Arctic. Here, the growing season is short, and the winter is long and cold. Although the climate is severe, the region is not lifeless. We are going to see some of the different forms of life, both plant and animal, that have become adapted to this unusual environment. The region we are investigating is near Hudson Bay, about 2,000 miles north of the United States. It is part of the borderlands between the northern forests and the Arctic barrens. The principal town here is Churchill on Hudson Bay. Scattered along the rivers of this region are small villages. Most of the people here are Indians, who long ago worked out a pattern of living suited to this far north country. Their main occupation is still hunting, fishing, and trapping. Indian families, including the children, come to the trading post in the village to get supplies for the long, hard winter. In this far northern land, all living things, plants and animals, including man, must be well adapted to the unfavorable climate in order to live. White men have also settled in the region. Many of them live in isolated cabins and make their living by trapping fur-bearing animals. From these come the hides or pelts which the trapper sells. Sled dogs are important to the trapper's success. They are called huskies and are used to pull the trapper's sled in the winter. Strong and intelligent, the husky is one of man's best friends in the far north. Close to the dog kennels and to the cabins of the trappers, there are many other living things that make their homes in this Arctic borderland. Here, perched on the cabin roof, is a grouse. About the size of a small chicken, the grouse is a source of food for man and meat-eating animals. Another kind of grouse is the ptarmigan, which remains in this region all year round. In summer, the color of the ptarmigan is brown, but now, in late fall, it is turning white. By winter, the plumage will be completely white to match the color of the snow. This hawk, a swift bird of prey, will eat a grouse, ptarmigan, or any other small animal it can kill. Meat-eating birds, such as the hawk and this northern shrike, often remain in the far north all winter. But most of the birds, such as this small hairy woodpecker and this pine finch, are getting ready to migrate to the south as the warm, lingering autumn comes to an end. Already the Canada geese are leaving the Hudson Bay region and flying south, a sure sign that the long, cold winter is on the way. We have seen some of the many different things that live in the forest zone on the border of the Arctic. North of this zone, where trees are sparse, are the barren lands, the treeless tundra that stretches for miles in every direction. The tundra itself is covered with a living blanket of mosses, lichens, berries, herbs, and other small plants, which are a food supply for many animals. The tundra is the home of one of the most common animals of the Arctic, the caribou. These caribou have just come down from the open tundra and are moving south into the borderland forest. A species of reindeer, they are the most important animals in this region. Both Indians and white men depend on caribou meat as one of their main foods. The hides of these big animals are also used to make warm clothing. The caribou migration, which is rarely photographed, begins in late fall. The animals move in great herds from the barren tundra of the Arctic down to the borderland forests of the Churchill region and farther south to the woodlands. Maintaining a steady pace all day and resting at night, they travel in groups that may vary in number from a few to 100 or more. The migration of the caribou is another sign that winter is coming. Suddenly, the freeze-up is here, and winter has arrived. On the riverbanks, the trees are covered with a coating of ice called rime frost. This is formed when cloudy or foggy atmosphere is suddenly cooled. A temperature drop of 40 degrees in one day is not unusual in this region. A nearby lake, now frozen over, offers an easy path for the last of the migrating caribou. Equipped with broad hoofs which have sharp edges, the caribou can walk and even run on the smoothest ice. Another example of the adaptation of animals to their environment. In December, the caribou shed their antlers. New antlers will grow again in the spring. The caribou's big horns and sharp hoofs are weapons of defense against enemies. The skeleton of a caribou killed by wolves is a vivid reminder of the day-by-day struggle for existence. That struggle for existence affects all the living things in this region. The small stunted trees remind us that living is difficult in this borderland of the Arctic, where the average midwinter temperature is 22 degrees below zero. The north wind brings the worst weather of all, a blizzard. The landscape is covered with billows of snow as the blizzard howls through the day and on into the night. The morning after the blizzard dawns clear and bright. Everywhere the deep snow lies in gleaming white drifts. The trapper's cabin is almost covered, but now that the wind and snow have stopped, signs of life are reappearing. A snow bunting is busily searching for food. A species of finch, the snow bunting breeds in the Arctic. It seems well adapted to the rigorous life of the far north, and is often called the snowbird, or snowflake. Here are the tracks of some birds we have seen once before. Do you recognize them now in their winter plumage? They are ptarmigan. These birds, you remember, were brown in the fall. Now, completely white, they are a striking example of protective coloration. They blend so well with their snowy background that they are almost invisible. This remarkable example of camouflage illustrates again the way in which living things are adapted to their environment. At the cabin, preparations are being made to go out to the traps. The huskies are excited. Of course, they know they're going to pull the trapper's sled, and they're eager to get out and follow the trail. A thick coat of hair and well-padded feet make it possible for the husky to withstand the coldest weather of a northern winter. The trapper, too, wears a warm parka of caribou hide and warm footgear of wool socks, felt inner shoes, and moose hide outer shoes. Thus, man adapts himself to the cold. Now the harnesses are checked, and the dog team is ready for the long journey. A trapper often depends on his dogs to find the way to the traps, for they have an excellent sense of direction, even though the blizzard has covered everything with deep snow. Among the many fur-bearing animals which trappers seek is the red fox. This cunning animal has become adapted to almost every kind of environment in the United States and Canada. Walking along on his snowshoes, the trapper is always on the alert for tracks in the snow. Here are the tracks of another fur-bearing animal that the trapper recognizes at once. There's no doubt about it. These peculiar slide marks, which look like the trail left by a small sled, are made by the playful Canadian otter sliding along on the snow. Canadian otters live mainly on fish, frogs, and crayfish, and so they are usually found near a stream or lake. Although rather clumsy on land, they are very much at home in the water. Often they will play for hours diving and swimming. A thick coat of fur and a layer of body fat protect them from the cold, icy water. And so the otter, like the other living things we have seen, illustrates adaptation to a particular environment. Such an environment, you remember, is the Churchill region of Manitoba, a cold and sparsely settled area at the very edge of the great barren lands of the far north. Here, all living things, plants, and animals, including man, must meet the problems of living on the borderland of the Arctic.